Hello, Jacque. How are you today?
Great.
Yeah? Have you just come from India?
Yes.
How did you find it?
Smoggy, a lot of poverty, a lot of regimentation, and very little acts of freedom. It seems to me the people were highly regulated, and the atmosphere was full of toxic materials, the water dirty, due to the fact that they don't have the proper technology to help maintain cleanliness. Mm-hmm.
When you say it seems like a regimented society, what do you mean by that?
Well, that the control group, whatever that is, influences the behavior to a large extent. The only type of behavior that may seem free is their religious notions about karma. You know what I mean by that?
Yes.
The law of karma, rather than the physical factors that shape behavior. I don't believe people are here to meet the test. I think they're here. And I think of you as a baby, if you were raised by the hedge hunters of the Amazon, as a baby, if you never saw anything else, you'd be a hedge hunter.
Yes.
So I won't believe you're good or bad. I believe you reflect your culture.
Sure.
But if I said to you, doesn't it bother you to have 5 shrunken heads? You might say, yes, my brother has 20. But would you be insane? No.
No.
You'd be normal to that culture. Mm-hmm. I believe there was a time when the Romans used to feed Christians lions. To get a better show, they'd starve the lions for a week. Mm-hmm. And they'd take the clothes off the Christians to make it easier for the lions to tear them to pieces.
Yeah.
And I believe families used to come maybe on weekends to see Christians being fed lions. The kids might say, Daddy, can I come next week to see Christians being fed lions? And Daddy might say, yeah. If you behave yourself. Now, is he insane or the kid? No. That's normal to that culture, just like boxing is normal to this culture. Obviously, I'm against boxing because it hurts the brain of the people involved. It gives them less ability to cope with things. Mm-hmm. So I'm not against boxing as an ethical practice. But people use it as self-defense. I believe if children were appropriately educated in schools, they wouldn't want to watch a boxing match. They wouldn't want to watch a person fly upside down through a hangar. So I ask, why do people do that in the first place? Maybe because they lack recognition. Well, they want recognition. That's why a guy will do loops near the ground with a girl picking up a handkerchief from the ground. Because people are insane, not insane. Insane means that's the way you were brought up. You hate Jews, Filipinos, and blacks. That's the environment you come from. I believe if you were brought up in the deep south, you might speak with an American southern accent. And you might say, I'm gonna get me a nigger and I'm gonna string him up. That isn't you talking. That's what you picked up from the environment you live in. However, if you live in a liberal environment and you move to that area, you can see some of the things.
Yeah.
But if you've never been brought up to read anything else, you reflect your culture. That's why I don't believe there are good or bad people. I think people reflect their culture. And it depends on what aspect of the culture you've been exposed to. So I don't want to kill capitalists or communists or socialists or fascists. I think if you were brought up as a baby in Nazi Germany, all you see is Heil Hitler, Deutschland über alles, Germany above all. If that's the way you're brought up, it seems normal to you.
Yes,
so
but
I don't hate anybody.
No, absolutely. But even in Nazi Germany, there were thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of people who, for whatever reason, were able to break free of the operating system of culture. So
I account for that.
I personally, Jacque, I don't know yet whether evil exists. I sometimes think it's one big scale from black through dark gray through to medium gray through to light gray through to white. Because we can have one man who rapes a child one day and then goes to work the next day as a firefighter and risks his life above and beyond the call of duty to take 10 children out of an orphanage. And, is he an evil man? Because he's hurt one child, saved 10 when he didn't need to. He took third-degree burns. But coming back to this idea of good...
Freedom of choice is what you're talking about.
Freedom of choice. Why do you think, Jacque, some people are less brainwashed by what Terence McKenna calls the operating system of culture? Why are some people less brainwashed by that?
Well, first of all, it depends on your exposure. When I was a kid, I would face the Ku Klux Klan and say, why are you beating up that black guy? He hasn't done anything. They say, he's a damn nigger. Mm. So I'd say to them, why are you doing that? And they say, a nigger lover from the North. Mm. They don't hear what I've said.
No.
They're sincere, but they're bankrupt, durably.
Yeah.
They don't have enough information to ask appropriate questions. I don't look at them as bad or evil. I look at them as victims of culture, just like Nazis. Now, if you were brought up in the South and you lived in the North for some period of time, your behavior is slightly modified, and then you move to France and live there for a while. You, instead of going to the American club, you live with a French family.
Mm-hmm.
You live with a German family, and get the feel of their culture.
Yeah.
So if you understand that a man brought up in Sicily, mm-hmm. might, if he came to this country, he might say, come on, eat, it's a good food. And he's sincere, and he means what he means, and if he drops his suspenders and belches, that's normal to that culture.
Yeah.
It's, my God, he's vulgar and he's crude. Mm. That's a judgment that you ought not to pass on people.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever people believe, I believe they're perfectly reflective of all the background they've been through.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when I heard of the word love when I was a kid, I said, well, they kept saying that there should be love and warmth in the world, and I wanted to know what love meant to that person that was using the word.
Mm.
I said, do you love everything you've ever done in life? He said, oh, no. I said, if you live with a replica of yourself, how long would you be together?
Yeah.
It's not very long.
Not very long.
So love, sometimes you like yourself, sometimes a little less, sometimes a little more. Mm. And if you marry somebody, whether you're bisexual or trisexual, try anything, you're going to like the person sometimes less, sometimes how do I ever get into this?
Yeah.
Love is not a fixed thing. It's a fluctuating thing.
Absolutely.
If you believe in the word is so. If you believe we call that a glass, that's the name we assign that, you have to go into the origin of language. Now, if you go to school and you ask questions, where did language come from? Well, they tell you that language was a method of communication evolved over a period of time. To me, it is not that. Somebody once banged his elbow and went, he banged him in, he ate something good, And language evolved from a series of events that we're exposed to.
Mm-hmm.
It took many, many years. And therefore, the language we use today was designed hundreds of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And that makes it impossible to talk to one another.
Sure.
We talk at each other,
mm-hmm.
because language is subject to interpretation.
Mm-hmm.
When you read the Bible, it says, Jesus meant this, and another person says, you're wrong, he meant that. And the third person says, you're both wrong, he meant this.
Mm.
That's why I have the Seventh-day Adventist, the Catholic, the Lutheran, the Protestant,
yeah.
based on language being subject to interpretation. When
mm.
you talk to somebody, they don't hear what you say. They hear, goes through their head and comes out in relation to their background and linguistic experience.
Through the filter of culture
so,
to which
right.
they are succumbed to. I call it brainwashing. I think all culture is
the
brainwashing.
The message that I'm talking about is we have to have a language that's not subject to interpretation.
Mm-hmm.
Chemistry, mathematics,
mm-hmm.
physics, structural engineering.
Mm.
When engineers talk to each other, they don't say, believe me, this is good material. They give the tensile strength, the torsional strength.
They have facts,
if
yeah,
they
evidence.
If they talk to
yeah.
each other and it was subject to interpretation, you couldn't build bridges
yeah.
or power transmission mm. lines.
Yeah.
It has to have uniform meaning.
Okay, I'm glad you raised this, Jacque, because a second ago we were discussing how there is no definites with morality, good versus evil.
Morality has nothing to do with anything.
Exactly, morality. But the thing is, most human beings, myself included, we exist primarily in the emotional world
yes.
of where we judge an
yes.
action being good
Absolutely.
Or bad, good
Absolutely.
Or bad. I've done my research into death rates, as in killing rates, amongst indigenous tribes
yes.
all over the world. And the facts are, before the agriculture revolution, men and women were killing each other at much higher rates per capita
yes.
than they are now. So for a lot, I just want to say to all the conspiracy theorists, things are, if we're looking at absolute death rates per capita, things are getting a lot more peaceful. I am comfortable with that. I'm comfortable with indigenous cultures, you know, battling it out for honor and killing each other and raiding each other's farms for cattle and so forth. But how do we, because when I look at the Venus Project, I see a utopian vision where almost we can change man and women's own internal spirit, human nature. How do we go about changing someone's nature?
Okay. First of all, as a kid, when I was about 15 or 16, I asked all those questions you're asking now. Mm. So I said to myself, how can you make a world of uniformity, bring all the nations together? Their social customs, their concept of God is different. They may have 10 wives, you believe in one. How do you bring them together? And I said the most difficult 3 words in my life, I don't know. Mm-hmm. I really didn't know. I said, how can I do that? So I said, don't try to design a global civilization until you understand what you're talking about. So I got confused. I don't say my own thinking is talking to yourself.
Yes.
If I say I'll see you Saturday, you know, I take the kids in and he said, I can't see you. See? So it's talking to yourself, it's nothing magical. So I talked to myself and I said, how do you know your system works? It sounds good on paper. You sound like, it's my own language, a utopian. Mm-hmm. So I got a book from the library years ago, and it was called 125 Utopias and Why They Failed.
Yeah.
To me, that was very important to read. And I read that book, and I came up with something slightly different. I felt that I had, in my day, a thing called a Victrola. You wind it up and the record would play. And I was thinking within those terms, and my age, like 94, I've seen so many changes that I couldn't accept the notion of utopia. If I design a very good city, that's the best I know up to now. But I know that that new city would be a straitjacket to the kids of the future.
Yes.
They'll design their own cities. Mm-hmm. So if you made a statue of me in front of that city, you hold back the future. Mm-hmm. If you have a laptop, which I'm sure you may have, okay. A laptop is not the best that can be. It's the best we know of up to now.
Yeah.
10 years from now, the laptop will be smaller, lighter, faster, mm-hmm. everything. Mm-hmm. You can't freeze anything, or you can't use the word utopia because it assumes you've done the ideal civilization, and to me that's ridiculous. Anything I design can be surpassed.
Yeah, of course.
Even in the history of my own work, mm-hmm. I keep changing things.
Okay,
I have no fixed notion.
But coming back to my question.
Does that answer your question?
No, that doesn't answer my question because all the visions of the Venus Project I've seen, they look beautiful. They are stunningly well-designed worlds. But it seems like a lot of the people that I've spoken to, not yourself yet, I'm speaking to you now, they see a world without greed, without fear, without murder, without governments, without police forces, without investment bankers.
How do you attain that if there's such a thing as jealousy, even a thing like that?
Or terrorism, someone might want to blow up.
Sure. Yeah. I met many different people in my travels, and I try to explain what jealousy is. Mm-hmm. See, they don't define their terms. If you ask a particular person, what is your conclusion now in life that you're 70 years old? Because, well, I'm a nature lover. I believe in letting nature alone. I think nature is a wonderful thing. I say, you mean you like hurricanes, earthquakes, which kill 1,000 people? That's nature too. Being ruthlessly honest, there are some aspects of nature that preserve life and some that are dangerous. A rattlesnake is natural. A cobra is natural. And an earthquake is natural. And meteors falling on the earth is natural.
Yeah.
So I'm not a nature exception. There's some aspects of nature I like. Other aspects are detrimental to human beings. Mm-hmm. So I have, when I meet a person, say I'm a nature lover, I say, what do you mean by that? Another person says, I'm spiritual. I'm not sure what they mean. So I say, what do you mean by that? You mean you have no locks on your door? If you see a hungry person, you bring them into your house and feed them. Oh, no. I know that what they're talking about, they have no real clarification of the use of words. Mm-hmm. And then I begin to get confused because I want to know what the Earth person means when he says, I believe in social design, I'm a socialist. I say, or I meet another guy who says, I'm a communist. I said, how would you prevent corruption under communism? I don't know. I said, how would you house the millions of people that need housing? I don't know. Then just say, tell me more about what you believe in. They have no information. Then I meet a friend of mine, or an acquaintance, not really that close, and he told me he was running for political office. I said, I'm so sorry to hear that.
Well, yeah, you
he didn't get the message.
He didn't understand.
Of course he didn't get. He said, what do you mean by that? I said, as politicians, I've met many of them in Washington. And I said, how would you stop cars from hitting each other? I don't know. How would you increase the agricultural yield without exhausting the soil? I don't know. Or what do you know about the physical world? I guess I'm not technical. I said, you understand that everything we have today, your cameras, your car, your airplanes, your communications, are all technical. And if a politician is not a technician, I don't know what they can do. I really don't know what they understand. I said, when you fly in a commercial airliner today, you don't have to call the pilot, say you've been flying at an angle, straighten up. He knows the business. The navigator knows how to get to where you're going. And it's all done by some branch of technology. So, is technology the answer? No. It has more answers than non-technology.
Okay.
Be good, be kind. What do you mean by that? So to me it means that everyone should have access to a relevant education. All people all over the world need clean air, clean water, arable land, and a relevant education. Relevant means no advertising, no lawyers, no businessmen, no investment bankers. People that have the ability to make food grow, take care of physical injury, those are the real people. I don't know of any other kind of people, but there are people called philosophers, which sit back and meditate on their navel or go into a room and free their mind of all kinds of thought and come up with wonderful answers. What is needed in the world is peace and harmony. How do you attain that? I don't know. If you don't have a method of solving a problem, they say, I don't know what you're talking about, Jack. So I said, well, if I had anything to do with it, with the running of a nation, I would take down signs, drive carefully, slippery when wet. I put abrasive in the highway so it's not slippery when wet. There's other signs, school district, 14 miles an hour. The power output would be 14 miles an hour. So you can step on the gas all you want to. And it says, dangerous school children crossing. I designed a gadget that looks like this, and when a kid presses the button across the street, he can't go across until the red light goes on and the pavement turns up like that. It's like a comb. And so no car can hit a kid. That's how I say I care. I don't know what it means. I believe in peace and harmony and goodwill. I understand the language, but I know it has no backup. So the Venus Project differs from other projects in that when I said to myself, how are you going to change people? I said, I didn't know, so I joined the Ku Klux Klan. Did you know about that?
No, I didn't.
In Miami.
Did you?
And I dissolved it in a month and a half. There were 32 members, including the head guy.
Were you the 33rd member? Were you the 33rd member?
I was.
Okay, because we all know K is the 11th letter of the alphabet, 311. 311 is KKK, and 311s are also 33, so some good numerology going on there.
Let me just give you an idea of what happened. After that, I joined the White Citizens Council. They hate foreigners. So I joined by identification, so they're identified with them. But I always worked on their leader, and I dissolved it in 1 month alone. Then when I came back to New York from California, I asked a lot of people, well, who are the most backward people in the area? They said the Arabs. And I said, what makes it? They said they still believe the earth is flat. So I said to them, I said to myself, I'm going to see if I can dissolve that group. But before I did, I found out who the leader was. His name was Elbaz. I called him on the phone. I said, Elbaz, can I come and talk to you? I know his dialect. He said, "You are Arab." That's the way he spoke. I said, "Eh," means yes in Arabic. I speak many little bits of language, German, French, a little bit. So what I did is I asked Al-Elbaz if I can see him. He said, "From where your father he born?" I said, "Lebanon." He says, "Come and sort me," means come and see me. So he said to me, when I get to see him, alone, he said, "You believe the world is round?" I said, "Yes." In his country, that means that's ridiculous. Then he held his hand up like this, and he pointed to his head, telling exactly what he did. He said, "If the world is round, man fall me down here. All the water he fall me down from the world." And I used to make wire recordings. We didn't have tape in the old days.
Yeah.
So I wanted to make those tapes to show in the future how I change people. Mm-hmm. So he said to me, you saw what I'm telling you?" I said, "Yeah." So I gave him a balloon. I brought the balloon there, and I rubbed it with fur real fast. Mm-hmm. And I put some cornflakes in his hand, mm-hmm. and told him to hold his hand 10 inches away from the balloon. Do you know what happens to the cornflakes if you rub it with fur?
I don't.
Electrostatically, they move up and adhere to the balloon. Called static electricity.
Yeah. Mm.
So his jaw hit the pavement after the cornflakes went all over the balloon.
I didn't fall off.
He said, "World, he magnet?" I said, "Eh. Ah." And he explained that to all the others.
So you showed them some
evidence.
An hour
and a half.
Yeah.
And I turned them around.
Okay, let's
turn people around with logic. Doesn't work at all.
Evidence. That's what they like.
Well, for him, what he considers evidence, not what I consider evidence. Then I thought in the Bible it said, "Honor thy father and mother." My mother was a racist and a bigot. She hated foreigners, Japanese, blacks. And I brought a Japanese kid home one day. She said, "I don't want that kind around." So I used reason, as a dummy. I was a kid, I thought reason is the bridge. Didn't work at all.
No.
So I said, if you can't get to your mother, you can't change the world.
Well, as David Hume says, reason. Reason is the slave to the senses, to the emotions, absolutely. Coming back to...
You want to know how I changed the clan with my mother?
How did you do it?
Do you want to know that?
Sure.
Okay. I befriended a guy named Lou Merlin, who was head of the clan in Miami, that group. And he had a war surplus store. You know what that is? If you don't understand...
Yeah, Army-Navy store, yeah.
Yeah. So I used to buy lenses. And he said, "What do you do with the stuff you buy?" I says, "Lou, you're welcome to come to my lab and see what I do with it." And I did different optical devices. And he said, "You smart guy." I said, "What do you think of the Klan?" I said, "It's a great organization, but it doesn't go far enough. See, if you attack, it doesn't work."
No.
He said, "What do you mean, doesn't go far enough?" I said, "Lou, after he visited my lab, he respected me. And here's what he said. Will you come on down to the clan, talk to our boys about what you're doing?" I said, "Lou, they wouldn't listen to me, you know." He said, "I did want to listen to you. You a smart guy." I said, "Lou, if you can do that, that'd be fine." So he said, "I want you to listen to this here jock. He knows what he's talking about." Because he was impressed by things I showed him. I can tell you what I showed him, too.
Mm-hmm.
Later on, if you want to
okay.
know. Anyway, he said to me, after I talked to his guys a little while, I tried to talk to them about animal training, because they're interested in dogs. They hunt a lot. So I showed them some films I did on a bunch of animals that I had trained that sit at a table, and I bring food there. It's real, and they eat it. Then I said, before I worked on animals, I worked on insects. I paint formic acid on a tin can, put an ant on, the ant would follow the formic acid.
Forever.
I'd say, "Hey, what? I've been here before." He'd never walk off unless I painted the formic acid off the can. And then I know that most insects respond to sounds, chemicals, light, in different ways.
Just for the viewers, formic is the Latin for ant, isn't it? Formic is the acid that the ants produce. Yeah.
I wanted to know how. Then I worked on animals. My greatest difficulty was snakes. In conditioning snakes, I didn't even know how to start. This is when I was a kid. So what I did is I put a black and brown mice in with the snakes, and the snake would center its head and grab the mouse. You'd see the hind legs kicking.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering how he swallowed it. The teeth have back, right, and they move up and back, shoving it down the throat.
Yeah.
He didn't swallow. Then I wanted him not to bother the white mouse. So I put a white mouse in there, and I put a glass partition between the white mouse and the snake. And he'd center his head on the white mouse and hit the glass. And after 10 or 15 times, when the white mouse was anywhere within the area of the snake, it would make an attempt. So I pulled the glass out then, and the white mouse can go anywhere in that cage, but the snake would only eat the dark mouse. And the next thing I did is photograph the white mouse sitting on the snake's head, you know, all going like it.
Yeah.
And the snake would be moving around,
and
never
bothered
the white.
You'd condition the snake.
Yeah. Then I said, what about nature, like jealousy? Is that inborn? Is that an instinct? Or is it learned? So I talked to a psychologist about it. He says, no, it's a natural thing, jealousy. It's all over the world in every animal. And I says, give me an example. He said, well, if I reach for my cat, the dog growls. Particularly if I put it on my lap and stroke it. So I said, is that what you mean by jealousy? He says, that's what I mean by jealousy. That's an operational definition. So I said, if it's instinctive, I'm going to try to find out. So I would feed the dog a little bit of fresh liver and then reach for the cat. And keep feeding the dog fresh liver. And after 10 to 15 times, when I reached for the cat, the dog's tail would wag. So if it's inborn, that wouldn't happen.
Mm.
The dog would still growl. So I had to reject that.
Mm.
So I began to talk to scientists, mostly psychologists in the old days. And I said, why do you adjust people to the system? It's insane.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they do. They have to be stupid to do that. Because psychologists are brought up with a routine of behavior, and they are given statistics that are not always accurate. And so I began to do a lot of work myself. Now my grandfather changed me in certain ways. He said, Jacque, people came from all over the world to America, and they brought the printing press, the Arabs brought algebra, that's the name of an Arab, algebra.
Mm-hmm.
And the Arabs gave us mathematics and the zero, and different nations gave us the printing press, and the language, we speak butchered English
mm-hmm.
in America.
Yeah.
So my grandfather said, if you love the earth, pledge allegiance to the earth and everyone on it. Mm-hmm. If you pledge allegiance to any one nation, you're negating all the other people.
Mm-hmm.
And that made sense to me. Now my grandfather in other areas was not sane. He was insane. He believed there were people lived under the ground that looked like us, that were replicas with chicken feet, you know, web foot. So there were certain areas of my grandfather's behavior that made sense.
Yeah.
So, in school, I refused to pledge allegiance to the flag. Apparently, the teacher I had at that time didn't like that. She grabbed me by the ear, dragged me all the way down the hall to the principal's office. I was only about 14 then. And she said to the principal, he doesn't want to pledge allegiance to the flag. So the teacher looked at the principal looked at the teacher and says, you're excused, you can go back now. And he put his arm around me. He says, why don't you want to pledge allegiance? Everybody does. I says, everybody wants to believe the earth was flat. It doesn't make it flat. Somebody said, what do you think of American history? I'm giving you the guts of what changed me.
Mm-hmm.
I said, well, everybody in the history books says the right thing and does the right thing and doesn't sound like real people. They make mistakes, they have errors in judgment, and they don't have any of that in the history book. Everybody looks right. So he said, well, what do you think of the teaching we do in school? I said, when a teacher says to a child, that's wrong, there's no information in that language for a child to work with. Well, that's not what I told you. There's no information in that.
Mm.
So I said, what is information? I said, the child spells cat with a K. So if a child spells cat with a K, say you're very close, draw the two letters that are close and change the K to a C. But don't say that's wrong, because it has no... He says, I'm going to have to call your mother in. So I says, oh, I'll do what you have to do. So my mother comes in crying, the usual, you know, what did he do? She's going like that. And he says, he didn't do anything, but we really have no place for him in our schools. So she says, oh my God, what's going to happen to him? He says, I don't think you have to worry about that, because I'm going to take him to the bookstore and buy him whatever books he wants to read, and let him read what he wants to read in school. I'll rope off the area, but I want him to come to me once a week and tell me what he's reading and why he's reading that. So I'll have to tell you a little bit about the other bits before I continue.
Sure.
Can I?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Okay.
We've got plenty of time.
Well, I wanted to know how airplanes fly as a kid on this thin substance. I could not understand it. So I asked my mother and father and my relatives. They had no information. So I finally went to the library and got out a book called The Wright Brothers. And I was very anxious because for years I wanted to know. I opened that book with great anxiety. And it starts out, it was a sunny day in May, and Mrs. Orville Wright was hanging clothing on the line. I didn't want to know that. That bothered me. And I had to go through the whole book was sunny day in May. And near the end of the book, they killed a pigeon, and they put wiring in his wings to keep him out there. And they moved the wings up and back to find the center of gravity and launched it. And that was information. And when I'm back to school and I look at the books, most of it was sunny day in May. A lot of bullshit and little information.
Mm.
So I began to read and scratch the bullshit, the sunny day in May, and look for substance. So I was able to read more substance than sunny day in May. Then he died in about a year and a half after he set that up, and they took away that privilege. So I played hooky. I didn't go to school for 6 weeks. One day I came home and the truant officer was sitting on my doorstep. He says, you Jacque Fresco? I said, yes. You haven't been to school for a month. I said, 6 weeks. I said, that's right. He says, what do you do when you're not in school? I says, I go to the library and I read what I want to read. I go to the Museum of Science and Industry and look at what I want to look at. He says, do you hang out in gangs? Do you use drugs? I said, no, I'm not interested in that. He asked me, what do you do at home? I said, I have a little lab. It's not very elaborate. He said, can I see it? I said, it's under a condition that you don't tell my mother who you are, because she would become hysterical.
Yeah.
He said, I agree. I shook hands with him, and I showed him my lab. Then he said, I can't say you're wrong, you're not doing anything bad. He says, you can do me a favor if you want to. I said, what kind of favor? He says, show up Monday, just to show that I did my job, and you can play hooky all you want to. So I liked the guy, he was a nice guy, and I did that, and I never went back to school. I began to hitchhike toward California. Why? Because airplanes dropped pamphlets. They said, come to California, there's lots of jobs. And I couldn't get a job, my father couldn't get a job. This is during the Depression. The banks failed. Mm-hmm. They paid off a new home. They didn't pay it off. They made down payments and several payments. When the banks failed, they couldn't continue the payments. So they were evicted. Like 15 million people in my area was sleeping in every empty lot. That was the beginning of social conscience. Mm-hmm. I looked at store windows. There were phonographs. You know, the only thing you wind up, there were all kinds of things available, but they didn't have money. They were good people. They made shacks. And at the same time, I had read there was going to be a bonus march on Washington by the veterans of World War I. That's years after the war. The government promised soldiers $600, but they didn't have the money at the time to give these millions of guys $600. So they marched on Washington with their uniforms, the medals, crutches, wheelchairs, and they were sleeping in every empty lot around the Capitol. Well, I was a kid in Washington watching that, and General Douglas MacArthur, I don't know if you ever heard of him, he was a captain then. He said, the Senate said, get those guys out of here, it doesn't look good. So he ordered them to leave, and they said, not until we get our bonus. So he had his troops throw tear gas at them. And that bothered me, no end.
Well, they were tear-gassing soldiers.
Yes, tear-gassing veterans.
Yeah, because they
wanted their bonus that the government promised them.
Yeah.
And then I said to myself, this shit's got to go. It would look very bad to me.
Yeah.
Because there was stuff around. Farmers grew food, but people didn't have the money to buy it, so their crops were rotting away. And I noticed at that time it was a depression. Now, you'll have to take my word for it because you weren't around then. There were people up on soapboxes with an American flag and a Nazi flag, talking about the Nazi point of view.
Yeah.
There was socialists, communists, Mankind United, all kinds of people talking of new ideas. It was the depression that stimulated that.
Yeah.
Where they lost confidence in their elected leaders.
Kind of like we have now.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I was standing in front of a communist speaking, and he said, "Beat it, Sonny." As I was just 16 or so. It was all adults. No kids weren't interested in that. Mm-hmm. But I was standing there, and he said, "I told you to beat it." I said, "I want to hear what you've got to say." He said, "Why?" "Because I don't believe what the Democrats say about the Republicans or what the Republicans say about the Democrats. I want to hear from a communist what communism is." He says, "You can stay." So an hour later, he said to me, I said to him rather, "I want to ask you 1,000 questions." He said, "You have to go to the YCL. I said, "What's that?" He said, "Young Communist League." I said, "Where are they?" He gave me an address. And I went there, and there were kids, boys and girls, 10 years to 17, and they were reading books like Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment. The kids were not typical. They were different than normal.
Yeah.
They were much brighter. And so I waited till the meeting was over, and I raised my hand and said, "How are you going to prevent corruption when communism comes in? And how are you going to house the masses?" He said, "Well, when that time comes, we'll work on it." I said, "Look, it sounds very humane. Let's start a technical branch of the Communist Party and work on mass housing." They said, "You're a deviationist." I said, "What's that?" "You're deviating from the teachings of Marx." I said, "I'm trying to help. I'd help anybody."
Yeah, but you weren't sticking along with the dogma, with the kind of program. You weren't sticking along with their dogma. That's why you were a threat.
How are you going to do this? And they said, "Well, that time comes, we'll work on it." And I suggested, "Let's work on it now." So he said, "You'll have to leave. You're deviating from Marx." But the vice president of the Young Communist League said, "Let's hear him out." And they kicked us both out. Mm-hmm. Well, this guy was dumb, I think, because I was only going to help anybody.
Yeah.
Anyway, mm-hmm. After they kicked us out, that was the time I hitchhiked to California. And this woman driving the car, descriptively, she must have weighed over 300 pounds. Brand new car. Big hat with cherries and feathers. That was normal when I was a kid. So she opened the door part of the way. She said, "Are you a Christian?" I said, "What else?" She said, "Get in." So she let me in the car, and I fell asleep because I haven't slept for days walking on the road. And she poked me in the ribs. She really did hurt me. Mm-hmm. She said, "You're not sleeping in my car." I said, "What do you want me to do?" "I want you to sing all the way to Texas." I said, "What do you want me to sing?" "Jesus loves me, that I know, of course the Bible tells." I had to sing all the way to Texas, but I realized that as a religious person, she didn't understand what she was reading.
Yeah.
She didn't understand the Bible.
Sure.
When I got to California, mm-hmm. I went to where the airplane said there are jobs. And there were hundreds of people there. And the guy said, "Will you work for 8 cents an hour? Will you work for 7 cents an hour?" And picked the low bidders. And that was very cruel to me. So I hitchhiked to one of the aircraft factories. And I was about, I'd say nearly 18. And I said, "I'd like a job." They said, "Are you a draftsman, an engineer? You understand an aerodynamic?" I said, "No." I said, "We can't hire you. You're a high school graduate." I said, "That's true." So I showed him my drawings, and he said, "You're hired." I said, "What do you want me to do?" "Just think up ideas." I said, "What are your problems?" He said, "Well, when a big plane lands," I'm giving you detail, "the big tires sometimes cost $10,000 a piece on a Ford Trimotor or a Condor. and the tires wear out fast. So I put vanes on the side of the wheel on the landing gear. When you were in the air, wheel would turn. But if a landing gear was retractable, when they straightened out, the wheels would turn by the vanes on the side.
Yeah, so they'd already be spinning, there'd be less rub, yeah, when they hit the ground, yeah.
Everything I thought of belonged to that company. I worked there for some time. And the guy said, the first 3 weeks you were here, Jacque, you made more contributions to the aircraft industry than the history of aviation. That's a chief draftsman. And he said to me, how do you think of all these things? I said, that's a long story. So he invited me to his home for dinner, and I explained it. He says, I want you to meet the chief aerodynamicist. Mm-hmm. That's a guy that studies airflow over wings and around surfaces. So he told him that I did not believe in the Bernoulli principle. Do you know what that is?
No.
Air flowing over the top of the wing covers a greater distance and creates a partial vacuum.
So it creates lift.
And two-thirds of the lift comes from the top of the wing, not the bottom. So I built a model wing to test that out. In order to deflect air up this way, you have to take a down load in the wing. Do you understand? If air hits and gets deflected that way, if you hold a rocket at an angle,
you'd think it would push the wing down.
That's the resultant. So you get nothing for nothing.
Yeah.
I was telling Ford, the guy that hired me, that. So I didn't accept a Bernoulli pencil. He told that to the chief aerodynamicist. And he came over to me and says, you don't accept the Bernoulli principle? I said, no, I don't accept certain aspects of it. He says, I don't even want to talk to you. And he walked away. Very famous guy, Dr. Klein. Mm-hmm. And that's the first time I encountered a scientist that was unscientific.
Yeah.
He should have said, what is it you have against it? Mm-hmm. If he was a scientist, he'd try to help me if I were wrong. And so I began to say, gee, if a scientist behaves like that, then I mustn't honor scientists. I have to check them out, each one of them. I said, that's a tough job. So I got into a field called general semantics. The book is called Science and Sanity by Alfred Korzybski. He began to tell me that words people use are not information. They're just names they get in school. And that book really made me aware of language, communication. So I began to study semantics, followed by another book called Tyranny of Words by Stuart Chase. That would help you if you're really interested in the history of language. So I got Mind in the Making by James Harvey Robinson, How We Get to Be the Way We Are. And all of those books were based on experiment, not armchair philosophy. So I became highly experimental. Following that, I was working on a certain airplane called the DB-7, Douglas Bomber 7. And I didn't work on the bombing mechanisms. They always asked me to, so I don't know how to do that. Only safety devices for aircraft. And that plane had a tendency, I built a model of it and put it in a spin tunnel, and it went into a spin right away. Instead of a diving spin, it was a flat spin. And the aerodynamics book said that most flat spins are fatal. Planes do not pull out. So I went to work on that problem and showed Ford, if you turn your wingtips this way, you can stop a flat spin. He said, great, I'm going to take out a patent on it.
Mm-hmm.
In the name of Douglas, Division of Northrop Aircraft.
Rather than in the name of Jacque Fresco, yeah.
Yeah. Everything you think of, whether you're home or not, is taken by the company you work for.
Yeah.
So, and I thought that was unjust. I thought that was unfair. I never got an increase in pay or anything. Eventually, it went into a flat spin. And Ford said to me, we're in now. We both were asked to resign. You understand?
Yeah.
Because the establishment would have been held responsible. So I was looking for justice. I thought it was unfair.
Mm.
And then I realized there's no justice. That free enterprise ships things out because it costs less than making it here in America. That cigarettes kill people, but the government gets a good piece of the action. That means they didn't care for people.
Mm-hmm.
That was the evidence I had.
Mm-hmm.
And whiskey and all that junk food, which goes out to people, and then the artificial contamination of plants by genetics without long-term testing. That was dangerous to genetically alter a plant where you could grow things organically, but never a mono plant system. You have to have mixtures of different plants that reinforce one another. So I began to turn away from commercial agriculture, commercial science, you understand?
Mm-hmm.
I was interested in science, but they were owned by corporations. Scientists made nuclear weapons. A guy named Albert Einstein wrote a formula, and he helped, and the Szilard and Oppenheimer worked on the atom bomb. And in the Bible, there was something useful. It said, cast ye not pearl before swine. You know what that means?
No.
Don't give people things that they're not ready to use intelligently.
Mm.
So technology became a lever of the armed forces and government, where they worked on killing machines. Of course, they were patriotic. In Germany, the German scientists, some of them left, but most of them stayed and made weapons. In Italy, the Catholic engineers made airplanes against America. In America, the American Catholics made planes. And the priests used to dip their stick in holy water and bless the airplanes in the wartime. Whereas in the Bible it says, thou shalt not kill.
Yeah.
Love thine enemy. Turn the other...
I always thought the irony of having priests and chaplains in the military was delicious irony.
My background, which I think you ought to know.
Yeah, absolutely.
I just didn't come up with these ideas.
No.
So the way I was raised, I was forced to encounter those things.
Yeah.
Thank you.
No, you've seen quite a few things in your 94 years. So I need to ask, you know, one of the bogeymen of the whole truth movement is David Rockefeller. You and him are the same age. What is the secret of your longevity?
There's no secret. There's just a lot of work to do. And I don't think in terms of eating to live, I eat.
Yeah.
And I like certain foods and I just like other foods.
Mm-hmm.
But I was an organic vegetarian for years. Until I read a book by Chunder Bose, which I never heard of.
Good name, Chunder.
Serge Goddess Chunder Bose. He was from the Bose Institute in India. He went to the science convention in England, and he explained what he was doing, and they laughed him out. He was a plant physiologist. And years later, some British scientists went to his lab, and they found out what he was doing was so... Because what he was doing is so radical, he took some living tissue and stretched it across two terminals. He put a candle on it underneath it to see if he can register pain. And he had no oscilloscope in those days, but he had something projected on the wall by a mirror, which moved very slightly. But on the wall, he got the patterns of an oscilloscope.
I see.
And he said that copper wire showed the same reaction as living substance. So he had difficulty when first said, what does it mean life and non-life?
Mm-hmm.
He said, well, the sun is inorganic, but without it, all the plants would die, and man eventually would die, and all the animals, and that's inorganic.
Mm-hmm.
So he failed to separate the organic from the inorganic. Mm-hmm. They're all part of a common chain. And his book was so different that it changed me, and I saw cancer on rabbits, vegetarians, trees, dinosaur bones. I began to look into things. Then I said, what about the things that are beyond science, the physical, the metaphysical, the telekinesis, you know what that is?
Yes.
Moving objects without touching them.
Yeah, which George Lucas touched
upon.
So
many people that believed in that. I said, Jacque, why don't you check that out? And I read about a guy named, I forgot his name offhand, but anyway.
Astoria.
And he was from, I think it was from India, and he said he never used a telephone. He has the power of telepathy. And he said he never used a telephone in his life. He can always read a human mind. So I said, if he can do that, the hell with science. What am I busting my butt for? It takes a long time. So we brought him, I and about 10 other people brought him from India to America. And I said, sir, if you can read my mind just once, I will shout it from the highest towers and tell everybody about it.
Yeah.
He says, well, I do it all the time. So I said to him, if you're going to read my mind, do you want a full moon? What are your major options?
Yeah.
He said, no, any time. So I says, you want me to face the east or west? I want to give him the best conditions.
Yeah.
So he said, no, just think of something. I said, what if it's technical? He said, well, I won't use the terminology you use, but I will describe the event. I said, that's fair enough. But before that, I noticed him working with people. He was talking to a woman about 78 years old, and he says, there was a death in your family, either 3 months or the past 3 years. There's always a death in family when you're 74 years old.
You know what I mean? Yes.
So he seemed to me he was working with probability. You know what I mean?
This Stoya guy who was working with probability.
That doesn't mean that he can't do that.
No, but he can't prove it. Yeah.
Now, so let me tell you what I did. I pictured a little white mouse, due to my background, eating an elephant, not getting any larger, and walking out of the building. If there's telepathy, if he gave me that
answer, figured that out. Yeah.
I'm convinced.
Yeah.
But he didn't give me an answer. So I thought maybe that didn't work that time. Maybe he can really do that. So I then pictured a carpenter's saw made of metal. Can you picture that?
Mm-hmm.
With two legs. And it walks into the forest like this.
Uh-huh.
And a tree looks at the saw, and the tree cuts the saw in half. That's outside of probability. You know what I mean? If he got that, there's telepathy.
Yeah.
He didn't get it. He didn't get anything I thought of. But he did, when a young girl came on, there's only 6 questions or so. Why don't I have as many dates as my sister? You know, and he said, he'd give a typical story.
Mm-hmm.
But he never did any real mind reading.
No.
He did work with probability. And when the girl leaned forward, he was on the right track. She leaned back, he changed the subject. Then I met another couple that said they do telepathy every day and had them come over at my home. I said, would you mind demonstrating it? The guy said, no. He said, I want you to go from your own books, bring out 6 or 7 or 10 movie actors or 10 presidents. And he says, don't even whisper the name, just point. And I point to James Fillmore.
Mm-hmm.
This is the first time I ever met the guy. I said, now you call this guy in England, Mr. Throckmorton. You know this story? I called Mr. Throckmorton in England. He says, I see a president with 2 puffs of hair on the side, and his name is James Fillmore. And I pointed to a movie actor, I think it was Gary Grant, if you know who he is. Anyway, I pointed, now call this guy in New Jersey, Smithson. I called him. He says, I see a tall, skinny actor, an Englishman named Gary Grant, right away. That was the best I've seen up to then. Here's how it works. Before I went out to investigate that, I read everything I can on show business, mental telepathy. Hundreds of books at the library, and you can get them at Magician Society. So you're not qualified as an investigator unless you know something about the field first. Here's what I found out. He has a friend in England named Throckmorton. If you ask Mr. Smith, he's got a list. Smith means Gary Grant. Johnson means this actor. So, the way he tells his president depends on the name you ask for. Do you understand that or not?
Sorry, I just want to do some comedy relief. Someone's phone just went off. We're going to have to scrap the whole interview. I'm sorry. No, I'm joking. No, but
understand?
I do, yes.
So then I could not deal with that. Then 2 priests came to my seminar. And they said to me, Jacque, the trouble with you is you want to work in the material world. There are things beyond the material world.
Yeah.
Just take me there. So there was a woman in Palm Springs, California, that had the power, they said, of telekinesis, moving things without touching them. I said, call her and ask if I can come there. And the priest said yes, and they did call, and she said yes. I said, ask her if I can check it out while it's happening, because I really want to know if it's true.
Mm.
I don't come as a skeptic trying to disprove it. I wanted to know.
Yeah.
So she says, of course. I went to the Hall of Records before I went to her house. Her father was a magician.
Mm-hmm.
Her husband, rather. He died 10 years ago. Now, normal people will visit you for a while, but if your wife dies a year you're alone, then they diminish the visits.
Mm-hmm.
That was statistical.
Yeah.
So I went to meet her. She was very pleasant, very polite, and she put this big vase on the table, and it started to move with the lights on and everything. No strings, anything. So I took a fountain pen I had, and I hold it near the table, and I got a 60-cycle hum. I peeled the veneer off, and she had a bell buzzer upside down with four rubber shock knobs on it. The table was highly polished, slightly tilted. So I said, "Father Dunn, Father Dempsey, come here and look." And she said to me, "You son of a bitch, you get the hell out of here." I said, "I'm not your enemy, but if you tell these kids that are here today that you have special powers, they don't work on problems. See, if you pray and hope that it rains, you have to dig an irrigation ditch if you have a drought to yeah. help the plants grow." Mm-hmm. So I said to her that I'm not your enemy. I understand why you're doing this. Very few people come to see you. You're lonely. And when you do this, you win approval and recognition. So she put her arms around me. We were friends again.
Yeah.
But I did not try to destroy her.
Mm-hmm.
And so I began to study as much metaphysics as I can. Levitation, auras. So far, I've never found anything.
Sure.
Except in a book, a religious book, this guy had a halo, and many witnesses to that. So I got another book called Anomalies and Curiosities in Medicine. There are many skin diseases that are luminescent. Did you ever see luminescent waves?
Yeah, bioluminescence, yeah, okay. In the water. Okay. Yeah.
So these skin diseases produce the luminescence, and they thought they were holy men. They were just not qualified observers. You know?
Correct. Yeah.
So a lot of that began to fall away. Mm-hmm. In my background. So
sure.
Everything in my background became related to, do you have an operational definition for the words you use? So if I use words, I must have a visual picture of what those words are based on. And that did away with a lot of bullshit.
Mm.
Just getting closer, I got that from semantics. Then I met semanticists and asked them how they would change society. They didn't know. They had all the words worked out, but they had no operational definitions, that is, to make society better.
Yeah.
Then I got to meet Italian kids in America. The Italian kids spoke like this, "Hey, where you going, eh? Make me get a ride on your bike," means may I use your bike. And then I met Irish kids, and they say, "There's a fine Irish lad, a good fellow, from Dublin," you know. And I noticed how their dialect reflected where they're coming from. And that the Southerners, "I'm going to get me a nigger and kick his ass," reflection, facial movements every day. Then I notice in France, they use their hands, "Vive la France, vive la Tour Eiffel," the Eiffel Tower, you know, and how they lips move, facial expression, exactly reflecting the culture they came from. But if they lived in Germany 10 years and came to America, they spoke with a German-American accent. "Gott in Himmel," means God in heaven.
Yeah.
And I noticed their facial expressions, language, and if they came from a certain area of Spain where the high people in the court, one of them lisped when I spoke, that all that Spanish had lisped in it.
Yeah, they all came from that
yeah. So
that meme that came through.
To understand the impact of environment.
Yeah.
This is what, how do you know there is no genuine people that can sense things people can't sense?
Mm-hmm.
So I would ask them, a person would come to me and says, "I belong to a new group, well educated, higher consciousness." I said, "What is that?" "Well, we're people that we have evolved far beyond the average person." So I says, "Are you a member?" And I said, "Yes." "Are you a member of the higher consciousness?" They said, "Yes." I said, "Where's your kidneys?" "I'm not sure." So I said, "How fast is the blood moving in your vein and artery?" "I don't know that." I said, "What do you mean by higher consciousness? If I can't check it out, how do I know what higher consciousness means?" Mm-hmm. "I know what he thinks he means."
Yeah.
"He doesn't."
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, I went to Trinidad because I read in a book that they can walk over red hot coals by state of mind. I said, "Boy, if a man can do that, you put meat on fire, it cooks. And if you can have a state of mind where you can walk over red hot coals, I want to know about it." I went to Trinidad because there was an Indian colony. And I read that they can walk over red hot coals. So I went there, and they do burn these coals until they have an ash, a white ash, an inch and a half thick. and they don't walk over red hot coals. They move pretty fast over the ash.
Over the powder ash, yeah.
I walked over the same thing.
Yeah.
And another guy came to me with a long needle, a crocheting needle, pulled his skin together and ran it right through his face, too. He says, I don't feel pain. So I had a friend that was a doctor there. I said, this guy claims he can control his pulse rate, make it faster, slower, just by thinking. And the doctor said, he's doing that. So I searched under his arm. He had a cork ball. By pressing on the cork ball, it weakened his pulse. So I said, here, doc. He said, gee, I didn't see that. I said, I know that. Here's how it's done. Do you understand?
Yeah.
Before you try to investigate anything, read everything you can. Get information. Because it's information that is closer to reality.
Yeah, and also it ties in very nicely because we've done 1 hour. I want to maybe spend the next hour, if I may, to ask you a few more questions. I get maybe a 1 minute.
I have to tell you.
Yeah, the background. Absolutely. I've got 1 hour left of battery. Yeah. I think a lot of what you say, I agree with. It resonates with me. The world is run by mumbo jumbo, and I think the biggest conspiracies are the organized religions, pretty much. It's mumbo jumbo.
They're ignorant. They don't understand a lot.
No, and also I think a lot of them don't want to understand. But let's come back to the Venus Project. First of all, why did you name it the Venus Project?
Oh, because I used to call it socio-cyberneering.
Socio-cyberneering.
Yeah, which means the application of science and technology to the betterment of all the world's people and the restoration of the environment.
Okay.
As long as you had separate nations, you're going to have trouble.
Okay. Why Venus?
Because later on, we went looking for land to build an experimental center. And I found some land in Venus that was not sprayed with poisons, toxic
Venus
on plants.
Venus, Florida.
Venus, Florida, yeah.
Okay.
Nobody could pronounce the word socio-cyberneering. And it was before cyber became well known and popular. So we named it the Venus Project.
Okay.
We lived in Venus, Florida.
Okay, well, that kind of, if, you know, that puts puts an end to lots of theories about Lucifer and the Morning Star, because a lot of people think, oh my God, Venus Project, this is a Luciferian, Satan-worshipping Nazi agenda or something. Okay.
It would have been the Deptford Project if they lived over here or something.
Okay, it could have been the Peckham Project or whatever. Okay, so that's that one. How did you meet Peter Joseph?
Well, Peter Joseph ran Zeitgeist film. And a lot of people wrote him after the film. They said, okay, what you say is interesting and informative, but what do you do about it? How can you change it? He said he didn't know. Roxanne sent him a copy of the book I wrote called It's a World Without Money.
The best that money can't buy.
Yes, it's and about a world that doesn't use money.
He found it extremely significant, and he came right out and started filming, and a year later, he put out Zeitgeist Addendum.
And he introduced the Venus Project.
And he came over many times in between, too, to learn more about it.
And he said, from now on, he's going to talk about the Venus Project. Because what he talked about was valid, but it didn't offer people any solutions. And all the Venus Project deals with is how to accomplish this, that, surgery, whatever. I designed thousands of surgical instruments, electronic and mechanical.
Sure.
Safety devices for aircraft. I was drafted into the Army. Instead of up, I said, no, I don't know how. I know how, but I won't.
Okay. Why do so many people on the internet worry that there's a connection between Aldous Huxley's Brave New World and the Venus Project?
Because they never investigated the Venus Project. They think that it's machines that I want to use to run everything. That isn't true. Here's where they get that from. A pilot, when I was a kid, used to look out of an airplane and say, I'm about a mile high. Then some engineer invented Doppler radar. It goes down on the ground, back up, and tells you you're 5,400 feet, 20 inches off the ground. No human can do that. So I'd like to substitute that for aviator's decisions as to height. I don't want the machine to take over. I just know I'd rather use that. And in San Francisco, it gets so foggy you can't see 3 feet in front of you. So they found out with infrared cameras, they can photograph the runway. So a pilot using infrared can see the runway if you use infrared cyberscope. And that, to me, became extensional. Now, you have to understand that word. Technology, to me, is extensions of human attributes. Without a microscope, you can't see the way things are. You can only see the way they are relative to your receptors. But with a microscope, first time I saw things under a microscope, what looked smooth looked like hills and valleys. So I said, what's it really like? And the guy blew it up again, and it looked like slivers. So I said, well, yeah, but what's it really like? He said, that's a stupid question. Depends on your receptors. Mm-hmm. With an electron microscope, you could see particles floating around each other, in which I thought I was looking for truth. He says, man can't see truth. There are radio waves here that you can't see. Billions of bacteria on the table you can't see. So he said, the search for truth is done by people that are sincere and have very little technical knowledge.
Sure.
So my vocabulary began to change, and my attitude about a truth seeker. In order to be a truth seeker, you'd have to know everything to know what that which is true. So it became a ridiculous thing. And then I met a lot of people, read a lot of articles about a young lady that was about to get in an airplane. She was about 16. She said something came over, she doesn't know what, but she didn't get in that plane, and it took off nose down, and 150 people died, and she said, Jesus saved me. So she was going to speak at the Hollywood Presbyterian Church. This was 40 years ago. So I went there, and she was telling the congregation how Jesus saved her.
Mm-hmm.
All the feelings that came over. And they all said, amen, God bless you. So I walked right up to the pulpit. I was not a member of that church.
Mm-hmm.
I said, he didn't want you, he wanted 150 people. That was just to show them, you know, the little girl, that she was self-centered. So that I waited outside the church to see if it affected anybody. And they shook my hand. They said, I'm so sorry, I used to think that way too. Which is good. I didn't want anybody. Like, if four of your kids were killed in a car accident and one wasn't, the mother said, Jesus saved him. It's just where he was sitting in the car in relation to the impact, you know what I mean?
Okay.
So I began to think, why are there car accidents? Why can't we put a proximity device on a car? So if a guy wanted to run into you, he couldn't. Because the proximity device would turn on your brakes.
I think what you've, I'm glad you just raised this, I think many people, including myself, are scared of a world where our free will is controlled or curtailed by machines.
Okay. But do you understand the Doppler radar? I want to substitute.
Doppler, I know the Doppler effect. I don't know what the Doppler radar
looking
is.
Looking at an airplane saying, I'm a mile high.
Yeah.
This way Doppler radar tells them exactly how high.
Yeah.
Then about 9-10 months ago now, there was an experiment in information retention.
Hmm.
And computers at that time could retain 1,000 trillion bits of information per second. Hmm. No humans can do that. So I want to put machines in Washington connected to industry, production, agriculture, to get an overview of our capabilities, not to replace people that can do the job better.
No.
And not to control people.
No.
Only monitor agriculture. Now let me just tell you something I'm sure you don't know. From 3,000 miles up in space, with infrared cameras, if you photograph the Amazon jungle, you'll see all the thick trees as red in a definite pattern. So the Earth turns under the infrared camera, and we get a picture of the state of disease of plants all over the world. No human can do that. So those are the areas that we wish to automate.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a picture of the Earth, and we have a picture of the ocean, which comes out when it's contaminated in different colors. And we can see contamination, death of the reefs all over the world. No human can do that.
Okay, so...
You understand that?
I do understand. Okay. But the problem is...
Can I take this a minute?
Yeah.
Yeah. People think that they're going to be taken over by machines because they think of it in terms of this society, the monetary society, and I'd be scared shitless of machines taking over in this society.
It's really going that
way. In fact, that's what's happening. Yeah. No matter how much you don't want machines to do things, doesn't make any difference. They're better than people. They're faster in factories, and they're going to take over people's jobs. But in this society, they displace people, and they hurt people. People use machines to subvert other people and hold them down and bomb them and kill them for resources. So it's not the machines we should be wary of. It's the abuse and misuse of machines. And as long as we live within the monetary system, it's going to be more fascistic. The machines will be more hurtful. That's why we wanted to, that's why Jacques came up with a resource-based economy, because they wouldn't be used that way. They couldn't be used that way if you understood what the resource-based economy would be.
I'll ask both of you. How do we do away then with 150,000 years of human greed and genetic desire for self-betterment through control of resources? And because if I have more resources than you, I can have sex with more women, pass on my genes more, and be the alpha male. How do we convince people that that's not
a
good way?
When I was about 17, I built a new kind of airplane. I better even tell you how I did it. I dropped a piece of balsa wood and rotated to the earth accidentally.
Yeah.
So I S-shaped it and rotated faster. And so I designed two wings on an airplane that rotate, not a propeller.
Sure.
Just rotated. And it went to the ground slowly, took off faster. And when I went to a model airplane meeting, most of the normal kids turned out normal airplanes. I never did. I worked alone. Some of them didn't fly. And I had to overcome the problems. And I didn't depend on approval from other kids. I depended on, I think I can solve this problem or that problem, and I learned to do that alone. But if I joined with other kids, they walked over and said, what the hell's that supposed to be? You know, they didn't say, that's an interesting type of aircraft, does it work? You know, they didn't do that. Mm-hmm. And they appeared to be abnormal to me, but made that way by associating with normal kids.
Yeah.
Then I began to disassociate with normal kids. And began to read and experiment. But I was reinforced for it, because when the teacher, when the principal roped off the back of the class and he let me read what I wanted to read, I was beaten up by normal kids. Mm-hmm. In the aircraft factory, when this guy Ford roped off an area and said, just think up new things, I was beaten up by the engineers. Can you understand that?
Yeah, because they don't want you, they don't want to deviate from.
So I began to lose respect for education. I began to look in the universities, and they were better equipped than ever with the technical equipment. But the wars were getting worse. They could bomb whole cities with nuclear and wipe out thousands of people in a few seconds.
Yeah.
And so I said, there's something wrong with our culture, obviously.
Very much
and
so.
So I went to work on a redesign of a culture. That's what made me start it. Mm-hmm. And then the problem is, how do you change people? For years had been brought up, generations. So I went back to China and started to study Chinese. And I asked Chinese people with correspondence, was there ever a Chinese baby born that spoke Chinese through the millions of thousands of years of speaking Chinese? They said, no, always had to go to school. Then I began to question, can people pass on experience to their young? And I tried that in all languages. No American nor Englishman ever spoke English without going to school. Mm-hmm. And we took a Filipino baby and brought up in Italy, he speaks just like an Italian. So you can't pass on acquired characteristics. You could pass on double eyes or triple ears or multiple breasts. But you can't pass on what you've learned. Mm-hmm. If you're a mathematical genius, you can't pass it on to your kids. But if you have a way of reaching those kids, you can give them the ability to do that. Mm-hmm. Then if you're born with a better brain, say, more neurotransmitters, you know what an idiot savant is? It's a guy that can tell you, you say, what happened in 1918, February the 2nd? That's the day the first battleship was honored. See, and they said, gee, what a family. The guy in other areas is an idiot. There were more neurotransmitters in a regional area of the brain. So, if you're born with a better brain than anybody, a better brain tissue, more neurotransmitters, you become a fascist faster. But the brain has no mechanism for telling you that which is relevant or irrelevant. That's based on experience. So I notice when a baby fox sees a porcupine, it doesn't know what it is. It gets closer and closer, then it sniffs it and gets stuck and stays away. And people say, you see, he learned. No, he was chained by the stick. They use the word learn. An old man's walking around and says, man will never fly. Then the plane flies over. He says, I've changed my mind. He didn't change his mind. He was changed by events. Mm-hmm.
Okay. How would we convince, let's just look
motion
at big names.
The best I've found out. That if I ran motion pictures in the South.
Oh, no,
the
I haven't finished my question. I think my question is going to be slightly different. Say there are some very rich families or dynasties which do run things in international finance or politics. You've got the Kennedys, the Rockefellers, the Rothschilds, just to take the bigger examples. How these people, to me, obviously love power. They love, like Chairman Mao, Mao Zedong said,
I agree with you.
They love power. How would we convince them to have a more egalitarian system?
I had a friend named Henry Berliner. He owned the Berliner Joyce Aircraft Factory. And during the Depression, I went to see him, and the government agents came over and said, we're taking over the factory. He says, why? You haven't paid taxes for 3 years on it. He says, I have no orders for airplanes. Take the fucking factory. It's not doing anything. And that's what happened in the States. Chevrolet failed. The banks failed. And we gave them, the same people that created the problem, money. We bailed them out with public funds, educational funds. And that tells you who runs the country. Obama did the same thing. So I'm telling you that that will not change things unless General Motors shows you a blueprint of a new car, better than the Toyota, better mileage. Then if you bail them out, you got a definite return. But if they show nothing, you just bail them out, it means they're basically corrupt. Mm-hmm. Now, they already lost their factories, but we bail them out. This time, there is no bailout. We've never had a condition where we went to war where everybody didn't prosper. Now you have wars all over the world and people aren't prospering.
Yeah.
With nuclear war, it would take 3 days. There's no time for profit. Mm-hmm. Do you understand?
I do.
So you can't make any money. So I say, if they were to conscript you to serve in the army, this is the way I talk to soldiers, they should conscript all the war industries so no one makes a buck out of it. Then it's real. Yeah. I talk that way to soldiers. They say, gee, that's right. But if you say, you're just killing people, they don't think, what are you, some kind of a foreign agent?
Yeah.
Show them what's missing. And if you can't do it linguistically, do it with films.
Yeah.
Now, films can get the millions of people. I can. I travel around the world. I may talk to maybe 500 people in an audience and convince them. I think I know how to do that. But there's millions of people. And if you movies, you get to millions of people in 1 month.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I recommend movies.
Yeah.
I will show movies of how I got to be the way I am. I would show movies with things that I really didn't talk to you about, that man cannot think or reason, all that's bullshit. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I show how the mind works, how we get to be creative, what creativity is. Mm-hmm. People write about it. The man is very creative, they're born genius, they have fantastic inheritance, or they're gifted. If a person's gifted, why give them a medal?
Yeah.
If you're born a mathematician, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? Why honor them? Why have a beauty contest? The girl didn't make her face, it was made of buttons, she shaped everything. You can give her a medal, but if she's born that way, why honor them? Mm-hmm. So anyway, I began to dissect the culture all over the world, and they're all full of shit, all cultures.
Yeah.
So it's easy to say Fresco is full of shit mm-hmm. in all the world.
Yeah. Okay, I notice you're going to be 96 in 2012. 96 divided by 3 is 33. We touched upon that. We have 33 minutes left of battery, which means I need to give you a harder time now and ask you some more difficult questions, I think. And,
are you mad at anything else?
No, but please don't get offended if I interrupt you as well if when we're talking. Do you trust Peter Joseph?
We don't use that language in science. Trust. That's invented. It comes from religion, the history of civilization.
Let me ask you again. Do you trust Peter Joseph?
I know what you're trying to say. Only in the areas that are relevant.
Mm-hmm.
Is that clear?
That is clear.
The word trust is not used. Yeah. We say his knowledge of electronics is great, human relations poor, 30%, 10% in that area. Yeah. We have no such word as he's great. They're wonderful people.
Because I've been told that Peter Joseph is not his real name. Why would a person...
Oh, he got death threats. For his first film.
From the Christian Right. In his first film, he had to.
I hope I get death threats from the Christian Right.
He's a very nice guy, by the way. Yeah. And he's sincere, but he didn't know what the factors were that shape human behavior.
Yeah, okay. Why do you think so many people think Peter Joseph is a paid big businessman, and that's how he got all this funding for his movie and his movie Zeitgeist One got seen?
I know Peter Joseph, and he... I know him personally since he's been over the house many times.
Yeah.
And he makes a lot of notes while he talks to me. He asks me thousands of questions like you're doing.
Yeah.
All the different questions.
Yeah.
Then he says, how can I help? I says, you can help by studying more and speaking less and writing more about physical events rather than your own opinions.
Sure.
He says, you're right, thank you very much.
Okay, a friend of mine...
I also know Peter Joseph, and I knew... At the time when he was making Zeitgeist Addendum, there were people who wanted to give him money to do it. He wouldn't take a penny because he didn't want to be under the thumb of anyone so he could release what he wanted to release.
Sure. Okay, a friend of mine asked me to ask you about whether you have any opinions about Theosophy or Blavatsky, these people.
Blavatsky.
Yeah, and how this ties into your work.
She started Theosophy.
Yeah.
She was the high priest of Theosophy.
Mm-hmm.
And you got the Ayn Rand's Objectivist. Mm-hmm. I read all that stuff for years.
Yeah.
And I can say that, is she a good person? Yes. Did she mean well? Yes. Was her ideas relevant? No.
Why not?
Oh, because she talked about things that no one really experimented on, mm-hmm. that no one really had the ability to investigate.
Mm-hmm. Okay. If there's, so I guess...
By the way, I want to tell you, there was a friend of mine who was an engineer, and he said, there's a Reverend May Taylor in California that has a church called the Church of the Living Dead. That's a name, I don't know. So she goes through the whole audience. Says, you had a son killed, what it'd be like on February the 8th. Write down everybody in the audience. And so I went to that church because if that's true, then my system is limited.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't sign the guest book. When you enter, you can sign the guest book. Now, that's what they do with a lot of telepathists, soothsayers. When you sign the guest book, they say, have a seat, and they go back and see if they got anything on you. You go to the Hall of Records in a small town. You had a brother killed in order to be elected February the 4th, and they build a record from the Hall of Records. So when you come in, they say, when you sign the guest book, the minute you sign, they go back to see if they have information. So I just want to tell you why. So I didn't sign the guest book, and she went over everybody in the church and skipped over me. But that doesn't mean that you can't do that. So I asked 10 friends of mine to go to that church and sit separately, but don't sign the guest book. I wanted to check around if she's real. And she skipped over those 10 people. So what conclusions can I draw? You understand?
Mm-hmm.
Reverend May Taylor made millions. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't like what I saw. Now, the guy that sent me there was sincere, but he didn't know how it was done.
Why do you think so many people feel that the Venus Project and the Zeitgeist movement are so appealing to the elites and to the, I say in inverted commas, the New World Order, the kind of depopulationist, let's bring the world into a technologically advanced. Why do people on the internet associate Venus Project with the elite depopulation agenda?
Well, first of all, one world, according to General Motors, is their one world. According to the Federal Reserve and banking system, their idea of one world is with them in control.
Yeah.
See, that's the world that a lot of normal people don't know enough about the Venus Project. So they always liken what I say to communism or socialism or fascism. They call me everything.
Mm-hmm.
Now, communism uses money. Communism has banks, it has armies, navies, prisons, police, and government. We don't have any of those things.
It seems to me,
Jack, I'm trying to tell you fast what the difference is.
Yeah.
It seems to me, Jacque, it would be impossible to bring in your vision because it would require 7 billion people, say over a period of 10, 15 years, to become nice at the same time. Because say we as British Americans, we decided, right,
I really understand that.
The Chinese, would say, we can now take over the world. And they might overnight, if we decided to disband things and be nice, they could overnight enslave us. How do we make 7 billion people in the world see the same thing?
Well, we went to war with Nazi Germany. Mm-hmm. We sent Lindbergh to Germany first because he was honored as first man to fly the ocean. I don't know if you know much about him. But anyway, he came back and he had this to say to the Pentagon. They are turning out 3,000 planes a month in Nazi Germany. We had 600 first-class fighting aircraft. That's all we had. So the government sent special agents to all the aircraft factories and said, expand your factories to twice the size. We're going to be at war with Germany, Italy, Japan, and Spain. So we needed expansive production. So the aircraft factory owners had a board meeting, and they said no. Because after war, we stuck with big factories, no orders for airplanes. The answer is no. So the government says, we'll pay for it. That's public funds. Mm. So they borrowed money from the banks, created a super debt with the public funds.
War bonds and all the rest.
What's that?
War bonds. They sold war bonds.
Yes, they did.
Yeah.
And they sold the public out. After the war, the American people owned 60% of American industry. And they gave it to them for 3 cents on the dollar. Gave it back to industry. Public doesn't know that. It's not in our school books.
Yeah.
As long as they don't know, what are you, some kind of foreign agent?
Yeah.
They got mad at me.
I don't know if you heard your question.
Well, I'll move on to the next one. Personally, Jacque, I think civil society, because it is untenable that it will go on to the future, I think it will collapse.
Yeah.
My vision of the future is we will all fight it out. There will be a giant World War III, for better words, and God help us all. I don't believe in God, but God help us all. I think we've gone, since the agricultural revolution, the wrong way.
I think what you're just saying has a higher basis of probability than the Venus Project.
Yeah.
But I can't accept that.
But the reason why I think...
Do you understand that?
I understand.
I can't accept. So I'm going to do everything I can possibly do, and Roxanne, mm-hmm. and the people that support it, to change people. If it fails, it fails. I'm not an idealist that thinks the Venus Project will be accepted by people. That I don't know.
Yeah.
It doesn't take everyone to make this happen. Most people want to know what's in it for me. And if things did collapse, if there was a group of people that can initiate the Venus Project in some way, and the Venus Project's about making things abundant and available for people, and if they see it's a higher standard of living for them, they would most likely accept it after things crash and they can't eat and they don't have any place to live and they have no job.
Yeah. Well, we all know that. To make big change, it's so much easier after chaos.
Yes.
Like in Hurricane Katrina, the companies went in there, privatized all the schools, no problem.
But if there wasn't a direction to work toward, if there isn't another alternative, and I don't see any other alternative out there that's updated with our science and technology for the benefit of people, not for the benefit of industries and corporations as it is today, but for the benefit of people and the well-being of the environment, then we're not going to make it. We'll turn right into fascism. So the more that people understand this direction, that there is another direction to work towards, and not people who misunderstand it and think it's the Rothschilds or one world government has, it's funny to us that, it's because it's so much the opposite, they haven't looked into it at all, then we might have some chance of some kind of sane, sustainable future.
Sure. I think what many people worry about, Roxanne, is that the Venus Project plans are very appealing to whichever people are left after the massive fight out. And I think it's very appealing. But say if I am living, if after the collapse of society, which I believe needs to happen, I hate this manufactured slave society we live in, and I think all the technology, all the luxury we have is built on lies and murder.
Okay.
And
we
on the
have,
yeah,
we have no
yeah.
problem.
Okay. What was my question? Oh my God, I forgot my question in my ranting. The Venus Project would seem appealing, but would
people in the Venus Project be happy if I took all the people back into the jungle and lived away from your society? Like, is it possible for there to be two ways?
The jungle, there's so many people on Earth today. I think that you're trying to ask a deeper question than that. Mm-hmm. Who makes the decisions in the future?
Yeah.
Who decides which way people ought to live? The carrying capacity of the environment, do you know what that means?
Yeah.
If an environment can support so many animals, if they're altered environment by earthquakes, the water goes into the ground, mm-hmm. most animals will die. So we study the carrying capacity of the earth and how many people do we have on it. And if we do use all the earth's resources, can we wipe out poverty? Can we build hospitals instead of digging up nickels and dimes for medical research? We, so far, up to now, we still have more than enough resources, even with all waste and war. Now, if you take the world cost of World War II, I'm talking about bombing England, bombing Germany, flattening it out, 400 ships on the bottom of the sea, thousands and millions of dead people, and just take the money that it cost to build, to fight that war, you could have housed everybody on Earth, wiped out the slums all over the world, built hospitals all over the world. There's something wrong with our culture. There's something wrong with all your bullshit mathematicians that are always doing higher plane mathematics. That's why I don't like this guy in the wheelchair that is interested in particle behavior. If you go to science, says, why do people kill each other?
Yeah.
Get out of that goddamn field. I don't give a shit about whether the planet moves and oscillates in an orbit while the world is going to hell.
Yeah, let's get our priorities right. Yeah. Yeah.
Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does.
Our problems now.
Yeah.
And I don't want to go to the moon because if we start going to other planets, the next war will be out there. And so I want people to learn to live together and go out into space as a joint venture. Is that acceptable?
Yeah.
I'm very much against any single nation going out there.
Well, absolutely, because it's just an act
where
of separation.
Where do we disagree?
Well, we don't. Thanks, Jacque. And this is a question for Roxanne as well. I sometimes, when I think of the whole terror that people have of depopulation, and there's a trust called the Optimum Population Trust. The Council on Foreign Relations talks about the unsustainability. The UN Agenda 21 talks about depopulation being... Maybe we all know as a species, as a collective subconscious, that the way we're living now is totally untenable. If the 3.5 billion Indian and Chinese want an American lifestyle, this planet will last maybe another 20 years. So we all know that the system maybe even needs to collapse.
I think you know more than they do. If you can impart that information, some people know this much, some know that much. So they don't all really know, and they think that somehow our government looks after us. They have false beliefs, or God won't let it happen.
Yeah.
Jesus will come down first. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So they have misinformation, and that divides us. So it's my job, when I talk to priests and ministers, I turn them around. I've changed many different ministers to agnostics, not atheists. But I've changed them so that they no longer believe that Jesus is going to come down the clouds.
Yeah.
And I tell them that those are little stories. And I, if you ever watch me talk to a group of people, I approach them differently. Knowing a little bit about their background, I change the tone. I don't talk to people to win approval. I talk to them by delivering what I know to be relevant, relatively so. And that I know that I myself, in 2 years, will be changed. If I live that long, I'll change things.
I think you will live to 2012.
I have no fixed notion of what the world ought to be.
Yeah.
It's a constantly... See, these are called... The word for this type of society is called established. The society I talk about is called emergent. It's never established. It's always undergoing change. To where, I don't know. Because the next 40 years, with so many new inventions, I can't extrapolate. I can only to a limited extent. The Venus Project isn't perfect. It's just a hell of a lot better, and it's a start. mm-hmm. work in bringing the world together. I'd rather attempt that than go down in flames mm-hmm. with society.
No, absolutely. Why do so many people use the word cult when talking about the Venus Project or the Zeitgeist?
They read the book. If they read the book
yeah.
and they say, your society has insufficiencies, I say, like what? Well, your beams aren't thick enough to hold up the building. Give me information. Mm-hmm. And they say, well, you want to stop cars from hitting it. How would you? I know how to do that. I know how to put up houses automatically. I designed one of the earliest prefabricated houses. Mm-hmm. It was exhibited at Warner Brothers Studios. They charged, I think it was $3 a piece, for people just to look at it. And that money went to the Hart Fund. Mm-hmm. You can look it up.
Everything new was ridiculed and laughed at in the beginning. When the Wright brothers were developing the plane, the scientists of the time...
Established, yeah.
Right, well, all of them were saying that man can't fly, but the Wright brothers never read those books, so they went right ahead and built the flying machine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we don't listen to what people say when they call it names and it can't happen, because if you listen to that, there'd be nothing new.
Yeah. Do you think, Jacque, the power of love could ever overcome the love of power?
Well, that's a quote I've heard many times. First of all, the word love doesn't mean the same thing as different people. So I always ask the person, what do you mean by love? I'm going to tell you what that love will crash and a new word will come in. It's called extensionality. If you meet a person with six arms, you might say, what the hell's that? He says, I can pet a dog, eat soup, scratch my back, and shake hands with my brother-in-law. But people don't do that. They think,
I know something I'd like to do with my spare hand. Okay. All that.
Okay. So the point is, when people use the word love, they use it in the context of the civilization and experience that they have.
Yeah.
In the future, when people meet, a guy is going to see how extensional that person will be to him, and they will associate with one another because of extensionality. Meaning, if you met people that taught you how to grow food faster, healthier, how to live healthier, if you realized what they were doing, you would tend to associate with people that were extensional. The word love has so many different meanings, so many different people, we would rather use extensionality. So when I told the aircraft industry, you can break a flat spin by turning your wind tapes into the wind, mm-hmm. when I told them you can get airplane tires to turn, they loved it, but the tire companies didn't like it.
Of course
not.
Understand that? Yeah, because it affected their sales. You need less tires.
So that's why you have to concern yourself with many different aspects mm-hmm. of the social system.
Okay. Well, personally, I think, you know how the Freemasonic Illuminati thing is order out of chaos?
Yes.
I think my personal role is to bring about chaos out of the order. Do you have anything to say about that? If for someone like
me,
I want
to... worry about it. It's going to happen.
Yeah, I agree.
It's happening now all over the world.
Okay, let's get more close and personal now, Jacque. We've got 15 minutes left on the battery. Do you have any religious or spiritual or esoteric or occult beliefs?
If I know what you mean by those words, I'll use the term extensionality.
Okay,
if you're extensional.
Well, like transhumanism, is that, am I understanding it correctly?
Yes, I'm interested in that.
Okay.
I believe that humans 500 years from now will be very different than we are. Mm-hmm. So different that we won't make the history books of the future. Mm-hmm. We're so low grade and primitive.
Yeah. Many people would argue that we used to be...
I don't like what I'm saying, but that's the way it seems. You ask me.
Why do you not like what you're saying?
Well, because I wish they would have been reasonable enough to make the transition without all the suffering.
Yeah.
They're not.
I have an inherent...
Sorry about
that. That's okay. I have an inherent belief that only when... Is that your phone?
Yes.
That's it. You're fired.
Which is what, so this is Marco Bass phone, so he's now famous for the phone.
That's it. Oh, I forgot what I was going to ask. I can edit these little moments out. What was I going to ask? Oh, yeah, no, transhumanism. Yeah, okay, I agree. Okay, three. Jacque, I agree with you. I think transhumanism does seem to be somewhere where human beings are going, but my personal belief is that we will only save ourselves morally
spiritually, physically, is if we realize that every move since the agricultural revolution has been alien and has allowed evil, for want of a better word, to manifest itself upon us. I'm very happy for us to go back to tribalism, indigenous cultures fighting and battling, because it's fair. There are no massive structured capitalist, communist, socialist things. Like even in China right now, one child policy, I've never seen anything more demonic telling people how many children to have. So for me, the reason why I was skeptical about the Venus Project, and I still agree, as I said in the film, I don't think you're going to hurt anyone, but I disagree that human beings can work towards this. One way I think this could work...
Suppose you say, how are you going to deal with this? Or how are you going to deal with that? To see if they have a way, if we have a way. So try that.
Sorry?
If there's an area you feel may not work, bring it up. Say, what are you going to do with this or that?
Sure.
Bring a specific question.
Oh, no, I think if everyone believed, you know, in morality and the power of good, like maybe you and I do, we could easily create the society. But we live in a world with so much tension and hatred that I think your vision is only possible post-apocalypse. And by apocalypse, I mean the collapse of civilized capitalism.
I don't disagree with that.
Oh, we're on the same page then.
Yes.
Excellent. So, and to me, like the reason why I resonated with the name, the Venus Project, it is that, you know, the rising, the phoenix risen from the ashes, the Lucifer, the morning star. It is, and that, this is my interpretation. I'm not putting words into your mouth. This is my way of seeing it. So I hope this film puts many people, makes them calmer about you guys, because I agree, the world is fucked.
Yeah,
it's fucked. And the Venus Project offers something which we could do after it collapses. Because I think, are we both in agreement, Jacque? It needs to collapse.
Well, people get mad and they say, why do you wait for the collapse? Why don't you do it now?
It's impossible to do it now. Yeah.
But we're working on it. We're not just sitting around waiting for the collapse. What's important now is to educate people as to a positive alternative, a workable alternative. And it takes a lot of education because it is quite different in every area.
Sure. Just because I've got 12 minutes left now, I asked you about any religious spiritual beliefs. You said extensionality?
Extensional. You know what I mean by that?
Yeah, yeah.
The microscope is an extensional device. It can see things I can't see. When I first met Einstein, I said, do you believe in truth? He said, what do you mean by truth? I said, well, this is smooth, I said. And he put it under a microscope.
So this is Einstein, you
mean? And it looked like that, yes. And I said, gee, is that what it really looks like? He said, no, he blew it up more, it looked like slivers.
Mm.
So I said, if you lock your frame, naked eye vision, this is smooth.
Yeah.
But to an insect, this is rough. Mm-hmm. To a germ, it's mountainous. Yeah. So I said, what's it really like? He says, that's a stupid question. Mm-hmm. We can't see what things are really like, only what they are to our receptors.
Yeah.
I said, I didn't understand you. He said, well, the dog can hear 30,000 cycles in sound. The best humans can do is 22 cycles, 1,000 cycles per second.
Yeah.
He said, sharks can detect 1 ounce of blood at 5 miles in the sea away. No human can do that. He says, so when you say humans are the highest evolved forms, you are projecting, Jacque. He said, there are many different animals. A chicken hawk can see a dime from the top of the Empire State, a human being a 3-foot ball. So when you say we're the highest forms, talk about what area. So when you talk about love, say, do you love your mother? In what area? I didn't like my mother's racial views, her prejudice, her bigotries, but she was nice to me.
Yeah.
She was concerned. So when you say I'm in love with that person, that's never true. You like certain aspects about them. And once you learn that it's a fluctuating thing, you don't become confused.
Mm.
You understand.
Yeah.
What I'm talking about is extensionality. In the referent that I use it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
I view my spirituality much in the same way as mathematics and the study of quantum physics, quantum mechanics, the theories of infinity. I think we are all a very small kind of reality. A very small reality bubble
so
from
far,
awareness. Yeah. What is consciousness to you, Jacque?
Well, people believe it's a degree of awareness. That animals don't say, I'm alive, I'm living on Earth, how interesting. And if you show a cannibal a wristwatch, open the back, you say, look at those fantastic gears. He can. He doesn't even have the association.
Doesn't care.
So when he looks at a watch, he grins.
Yeah.
That's all he does. He says, nice. Mm. And he'll wear it around his neck.
Yeah.
Never uses a timepiece. So people, depending on their background, do not see the world you see as you see it, because lack of extensionality in their education. They're educated to serve the institutions they're brought up in. They're not educated to what you call think and reason, go beyond that. We try to do that with every human being. And where we fail, we'll try to solve that problem. If I can't get to a person, I say, I don't know how to get to them. I don't say they're dumb. So I don't know how to reach them, which makes me work harder. Okay?
Yeah. Did you ever meet Carl Sagan?
I talked to him on the phone.
Okay, yeah. One thing he said to me, which, not to me, I saw it in a video, which resonated very strongly, is that consciousness, awareness, is the universe's attempt to understand itself.
That he doesn't know what he's talking about.
What do you
needs a lot of information in semantics. Yeah. You will get a lot out of that book called Science and Sanity by Alfred Kazifsky. It gives you better tools to think with,
mm-hmm.
and this is what we need, a lot of tools other than what we have.
Yeah. Do you think ultimately everything will be okay for the human species?
I don't know.
No.
How do I know that?
No.
We may kill each other.
Well, we've been doing
and
it for hundreds of thousands.
We may even build this beautiful world and a media smash it. I don't know. Who the hell knows? I saved the kid from drowning once, and somebody said, it's a wonderful thing you did, and I said, that I don't know, unless I see a picture of that kid's life mm-hmm. thereafter. If it became Adolf Hitler, I'd say I did a lousy thing. I don't know. How would I know?
Jacque, do you think there is one infinite consciousness and we're experiencing it subjectively?
Not at all.
No? What would be, like, when we look at the kind of
history of mankind, you can see that it never existed.
Well, okay. So if we look at the overall massive cosmological bigger picture, if you could sum up in maybe 3 minutes what's going on.
I believe that if a hurricane came and went over a church or around it, or if there's just children in a building and the hurricane went around that building, I say there is a cosmic consciousness. But hurricanes don't seem to respect anybody. And a tidal wave drowns thousands of people.
Yeah.
And an earthquake has buildings collapse on Jews, Swedes, Catholics. It doesn't
seem to
give a
shit. No, but that explains that, I think we're both on the same page about organized religion. Yeah. It's mumbo-jumbo brainwashing. But if we are all one infinite consciousness experiencing itself subjectively...
That,
no, okay, this is my words. It does explain why, you know, child rape, murder, Nazis, because it's the same thing killing itself just for fun, almost.
Well, suppose I told you what made a serial killer.
No.
Okay, you don't know that, do you?
A serial killer?
Yeah.
Someone that doesn't like Kellogg's.
Who kills women, stabs them, cuts them up, or eats children, cuts them up.
What
the
makes a serial killer?
The guy's name was Albert Fish.
Okay, what makes a serial killer?
Okay. The guy's name was Albert Fish. They believe he ate 40 children. And the public wanted to tear him to pieces or burn him alive. They were very bitter. A psychiatrist named Worthen. His name was Worthen. He said, don't kill him. I want to try to find out what made him that way so we can avoid those conditions in the future. I like that guy. And he is what he found. When Albert Fish was 8 years old, he was touching his private parts. His mother was an old-time Baptist, good person, came in and said, you are going to burn in hell touching that part of your body. That is satanic. And you will burn eternally. She scared the shit out of the kid. And the mother said at 2 a.m. he was screaming. And she went into the bedroom and he stuck needles in his genitals because he didn't want to go to hell. Can you understand that?
I do understand.
Then he used to take minority kids in the woods and try to cut their genitals off to save them from hell.
I understand.
What do you think a soldier is? He's a guy that saw movies of Japanese raping women. That's called propaganda.
Yes.
Because Japanese have as many rapists as we have. They're not all that different. But with propaganda, you can make people hate Germans, call them krauts, sauerkraut from that.
And or nowadays, Muslims. Yeah.
Bastards. Whatever it is that we hate, we manipulate, we make movies to get kids to enlist in the army.
Yeah.
showing medals, heroes. And I want you to know this. I worked for a guy named Ernst Udet. He was the head of the German Air Force in World War I. I worked for him.
Really?
I said, how did you shoot down 70 airplanes? He says, it was very easy. That's the way he spoke. He said, I would fly above the squadrons and look at the rookies. You know what that means? The amateur pilots weren't good at getting, and I'd pick them off.
Predatory, yeah. Yeah, that's how he did it.
Yeah.
When you were asking, how could you possibly do that?
Yeah.
And he answered, well, yeah, this is how, yeah.
He told me.
Excellent.
Same for Eddie Rickenbacker, American hero. Shot down about 65 planes. There's no other way you can do that. If you had equal abilities up there, you might last through 6 or 7, but not 71 airplanes.
Yeah.
Do you understand what I'm saying?
I do understand.
Okay. So to me, all the people that are heroes, they're all part of this sham.
Yeah.
Okay? Mm-hmm. I'm not mad at them or angry at them. I understand them. Mm-hmm. If you're brought up in this world and you have a machine gun and you kill 400 men enemies, they put medal on you. 5 medals.
Yeah, you're not a mass murderer. You're not a serial killer. You're a hero.
Do you understand? There are no mass murderers, no serial. They're made by certain conditions.
Yeah.
And if we don't know what those conditions are, hate substitutes for solutions.
Okay? Yeah. I find, I'm glad you mentioned
you
that.
You understand what I'm saying?
I do know exactly what you're saying. For me, I'm unable to be angry or scared of something if I understand it completely.
Right.
Yeah. So to understand evil, in quotation marks.
How they get to be the way they are.
Yeah, then it makes
and
them a lot less scary.
You know how to change them.
Yeah.
If you know the mechanisms of change, it takes... People say, how long would it take to change all the people on Earth? Given control of the broadcasting companies, movies, and the media, it's 3 months. That's all.
3 months?
That's all.
That's probably quite true. Well, they did it with swine flu, Islam.
The army.
Yeah.
I said, how do you take people out of church, kids, and make them killing machines?
Yeah.
We get a guy named Frank Capra. He made a movie called Why We Fight. Make the Japanese look bad, make the Germans look terrible. Make Spain look awful.
Works every time.
And it works every time.
Right.
How long did it take? 3 months. So give me movie control of television, radio, and it doesn't take that long because the people get the change. They change other people.